presents this unabridged recording of The 10 PM Question, written by Kate de Goldi and read by Stig Wemyss. The dedication reads, "For Luciana and Jack, at the heart of it all." Chapter 1. Tuesday, February 14. Tuesday, the 14th of February, began badly for Frankie Parsons. There was no milk for his just right. There was no go-cat for the fat controller, so the fat controller stood under the table meowing accusingly while Frankie ate his toast. The newspaper hadn't arrived, which meant Frankie couldn't take a headline and article for current affairs, and so would earn one of Mr. A's sardonic looks. Nor could he check the weather report for humidity. Humidity levels were important to Frankie, and for two reasons. One, a cricket ball swung rather trickily and leathily when the air was heavy, which was a good thing. Two, ants appeared in droves when the temperature was warm and the atmosphere thick, which was a very bad thing. Frankie nursed a special hatred for ants. So Tuesday the 14th began badly and continued that way. Frankie's sister, Gordana, had swiped the last muesli bar and the only crisp apple. There were no water bottles. The cling wrap had run out. There was no bus money in his mother's wallet, so Frankie had to search for a nail file in order to prise out 10-cent pieces from the emergency pink china pig. A nail file was always hard to find in Frankie's house, and today was no exception. He located one finally in the yellow click-clack first aid container, which lived in the laundry with his carefully arranged earthquake kit. 12 2-litre water bottles, 2 sets of spare batteries, enough baked beans, tuna, toilet paper and go-cat for a week. By which time it was 8:05 AM and furthermore, the pink china pig was ominously lightweight. Someone had been there before him. On Saturday, when he'd last checked, the pig had been quite heavy. Frankie shook her regularly, an almost involuntary but comforting gesture whenever he passed the hall bookcase, which was where the pink pig lived, beside the National Geographics. Frankie suspected Louis. His brother lived away from home now, but he came for dinner and laundry several times a week and was always on the hunt for small change. There were no stray coins lying on shelves or bedside tables after Louis had been around. Nothing made Frankie madder than a lightweight pink china pig. He relied on that pig. Experience had taught him that precisely when he needed it most, his mother would not have cash in her wallet, nor would his father. But the pink pig, the repository of everyone's unloved 10-cent pieces, generally had a belly full of coins. Except today. February the 14th. Today there was only $1.30, 50 cents short of Frankie's bus fare to school, which meant he would have to borrow from his friend Giggs. Who wouldn't mind, but that wasn't the point. "This house doesn't work," Frankie called up the stairs. He stuffed his exercise books, lunch bag and sneakers into his backpack. Then he stood very still and mentally perused the school day. This was his habit each morning. It was so he wouldn't forget anything. He was really very organised. Maths? Protractor? Calculator? Yes. Reading? Hicksville? Yes. Language arts? Concise Oxford? Yes. PE? Shorts? Sneakers? Yes. Cricket at lunchtime? Bat? Ball? Box? Yes. Lunch? Soft apple? Cheese and peanut butter sandwich? Carrot? Lemon cake? Secret chocolate hidden behind the rice? Yes. Art? Pencils, ink, sketchbook, yes. Science project, glue gun, statistic sheet, black paper, double-sided tape, Stanley knife, yes, 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 yes. "A bad workman always blames his tools," said Gordana. She came thumping down the stairs in her flat-footed, truculent morning way. Gordana maintained she wasn't a morning person. In Frankie's private view, his sister was a no-time person. Not morning, afternoon or evening. The less he saw of her, the better. "What do you mean, a bad workman?" he said, and instantly regretted it. He really didn't know why he ever responded to Gordana. It always ended badly. Every day he told himself to ignore her, and every day he ignored himself instead. Face it, Giggs had told him. You hate her. It's official and mutual. Your sister is your enemy. Stop consorting. It may be your fault if the house doesn't work, said Gordana. How could it be? Said Frankie. I'm the child. And there you have it, Gordana snapped. A child is precisely what this house doesn't need anymore. No bickering, please, said Ma. She said this automatically whenever she came into a room containing Frankie and Gordana. It was usually necessary, she said. We need cat food, said Frankie, and human food. And food for Frankie, said Gordana with a smirk. And money, said Frankie, and new batteries for the smoke alarm. Oh, good God, said Gordana. Not the smoke alarm thing again. I'll ring Uncle George, said Ma. He's shopping for the aunties. The aunties? A sudden and familiar heaviness settled over Frankie. It was as if someone had fastened large marbles to his entire body. Of course, why not? Tuesday the 14th began with no cereal, and it would end with a surfeit of aunts. Perfect. Oh, good God, said Gordana. Count me out. I'll be at Ben's. Ben was Gordana's boyfriend. He had a buffed body, a nifty wrist action, and absolutely no aunts. It all seemed quite unfair to Frankie. Bye, said Frankie funerally. He kissed Ma on the cheek. She smelled morning-ish, a mixture of coal tar soap and toast. After school, she smelled of baking, a fusion of melted butter, toasted almonds, nutmeg and vanilla essence. He liked both smells. It wasn't Ma's fault about the aunties. The entire American military couldn't have kept them away. They came every second and fourth Tuesday and stayed for dinner and cards. Sometimes it was too much for even a reasonable boy. Have a good one, said Ma. Fat chance, said Frankie. But he closed the door gently behind him. He would have liked to slam it, but Gordana did more than enough slamming for everyone in their house, and it always made Ma jump. Giggs was waiting at the top of the zigzag. He was leaning against the Forsyth's fence, reading a comic and pulling at his right eyebrow. He always did this when he was concentrating. There was a tiny bear patch where he'd overworked the habit. Better hurry, he said, not looking up. Financial emergency, said Frankie. You got a dollar? Sure. Giggs always had spare money. His house was awash with coins. $20 notes spilled from his father's pocket, or so it seemed to Frankie. They walked slowly down the zigzag. It was a steep path overhung with ferns and other greenery, which made it pleasantly cool in summer, but damp and treacherously slippery in the winter months. Frankie and Giggs had an invariable routine on the zigzag. At the third corner, they gave a swift pat to Mrs. Rowan's cat, Marmalade, who was always sitting on the letterbox. Marmalade was an elderly bundle of fluff and very inoffensive, just like Mrs. Rowan, Giggs said. Mrs. Rowan was old and kindly and had something of a beard. At the fifth corner, they took turns slamming shut number 41's letterbox lid, which was, inexplicably, always open to the heavens and the weather. They had been doing this for 5 years, ever since Giggs arrived in the neighbourhood, and they began walking to the bus stop together. Every afternoon, the lid was up again, and every afternoon, they closed it once more. It was an enjoyable little game between the boys and Mrs. Deprini, who lived at number 41. At least, Frankie assumed Mrs. Deprini found the game enjoyable. He and Giggs found it extremely satisfactory. Just before the 10th corner, they prepared themselves to ambush Ronald, the bad-tempered dashhound, who lurked beside his owner's picket fence, ready to yap at unsuspecting pedestrians. Ronald's owners were nice enough, but their pet was a loser and thoroughly deserved everything he got. What a dumb dog, Giggs said, bending down. He said this every day as he and Frankie crouched and inched their bodies around the 10th corner. That was the pleasing thing about ambushing Ronald. It worked every time because Ronald never learnt from the past. He seemed to never expect the two boys to burst around the corner and let rip a machine gun rattle of fearsome boy yaps, though they'd been doing this at the same time, twice a day, for nearly 3 years. Ambushing Ronald never failed to make them laugh like hell. "We'll know we're practically dead when we don't want to do old Ronald," said Frankie. "Does that mean we'll actually be sad when he dies?" said Giggs. He leapt up on the Ernest Burroughs memorial seat, balanced briefly and daintily on its upright back, then jumped down to the 13th zig. Frankie followed. They did this every morning too. The Ernest Burroughs memorial seat allowed a view of a cascading garden of succulents on the gentle hill face opposite. But Frankie and Giggs had never actually sat on Ernest Burroughs. He was merely their launching pad for the canter down the remaining four zigzags and along the riverbank to the bus stop. "Imagine Ronald's effect on stress levels," shouted Frankie. He lobbed the bus stop cricket ball up over the bus shelter to Giggs on the other side. "Sky high!" Giggs called. He cupped his big freckled hands ready. They were like the firm but flexible petals of an ageing tulip. Stress levels were a recurring topic of conversation between the two of them just now. They had an acute and quite professional interest in stress because it was the subject of their ingenious and completely secret science fair project. Their project would, Giggs confidently predicted, beat every other Year 8 entry. They were all wire and battery units, or plant habitats, or tidal river patterns, the usual old stuff. Their project was so novel it would enchant the judges at school, the judges at the regionals and the nationals, and probably the world. They had conceived the project together over the summer, but Frankie claimed the original moment of inspiration. He had been watching Uncle George in the weeks before Christmas, a period when Uncle G's work was particularly hectic and consuming. Sometimes after dinner, Uncle George would settle his substantial frame into the cushioned green sofa. He had a particular way of not relaxing when he was seated in an easy chair or sofa. His feet tapped, his arms jerked, his head was up and alert like a rotating periscope. He twitched and barked and generally disturbed anyone else's attempts to idle and lounge. "Keep still," ordered Gordana, smacking his arm. "You're 10 times worse than the Harding twins." The Harding twins were Gordana's regular babysitting charges. According to her, they were human hurricanes. Looking after the Harding twins was enough to prostrate Gordana for an entire day. The only thing that ever settled Uncle George, Frankie noticed over the weeks before Christmas, the only thing that stayed his perky head and flailing limbs, the only thing that shut up his constant talk, was the fat controller. When the fat controller leapt weightily upward and planted her big body in Uncle George's lap, a strange quiet settled over them both. Uncle George's hand kneaded the fat controller's head, tickled her ears and played over her massive back, and the fat controller spread her considerable length and width over Uncle George's legs. At the same time, a liquid calm seemed to seep through Uncle George's normally electric self. "It's like a drug," said Ma admiringly. "Stress buster," said Louis one time, which was the moment Frankie had his inspiration. It was Giggs who refined the idea for the purposes of the Year 8 science project. Giggs was a great organiser. He liked to draw up lists and charts and graphs and spreadsheets. He liked to underline. He liked to assign tasks. Their own task, he said, was to sit people down and measure their pulse rate, stick a cat in their lap for 5 minutes, then measure their pulse again. They would do 10 people each, he said, which would give a good range. They had borrowed a digital sphygmomanometer from Giggs's dad. As well as blood pressure readings, it had a pulse rate counter. That was the best part. Attaching the sphygmomanometer cuff to people's arms and watching it balloon when they pressed the start button, listening to the rising whine of the machine. It sounded like a light plane taking off.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.